subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
The Rajya Sabha passed the Citizenship Amendment Bill last night, and this was after the Lok Sabha had already passed the bill. This has led to massive protests in Assam, where the ethnic population does not want the bill to be implemented. What this bill has also done, given its controversial nature and the fact that it actually determines citizenship based on religion, it has invited a lot of international criticism, or in fact, is vulnerable to inviting a lot of international criticism. What we are going to do in this episode of Government Matters is look at this bill from two points of view. One, the situation in the country and how the centre is planning to handle the protests in Assam. And two, understanding how the international community is reacting or could react to the situation. Given the complexity and gravity of the situation, I have with me two of our senior editors in the studio, Noinima Basu, who tracks diplomacy, and Snehesh Alex Philip, who looks at defence. Okay, I'll begin with you, Snehesh, because you know what we've seen over the last 24 hours, what has unfolded is quite nightmarish as far as Assam is concerned. Protests on the street, there are tires burning, there are vehicles which have been set on fire, and it is something that Assam really hasn't witnessed in the last three decades since the end of insurgency, or since insurgency was at its peak in the state. Now we understand that troops have been sent to Assam, the army has been deployed in Assam. Can we talk about, one, how many columns of the forces have been deployed, and two, when were they sent, when was the preparation done?
Well, Rui, as you rightly mentioned, the situation in Assam is actually grim when it comes to the law and order issue. There have been large-scale violence that has taken place, and even, you know, there are reports of the CM house being attacked itself. As far as the army deployment is concerned, remember that army is anyways deployed in in Assam for counter-insurgence and counter-terrorism operations. So there was no additional movement of army as far as Assam is concerned. We already the army has about three divisions which are focusing itself, which are based in Assam and are focused on Assam itself. So as far as deployment for this particular issue is concerned, five columns of the army have been deployed. The five columns were actually requisitioned by the civil aid authorities, and they have been deployed. Five columns, each column has about roughly 70 personnel. So five columns of army personnel have been deployed to assist the civil authorities in maintaining law and order.
Right. Now, when was the last time that such kind of overt army deployment was seen in Assam?
Well, you know, I'm not really sure as far as law and order is concerned, but the last major army deployment for law and order issues in terms of was because of the killings in 2015, when about 17 members of a particular group were killed over a period of 2 days, you know, and that led to a violence. So it was, but it was again more connected
these
to the insurgency.
The
yeah, these were the Bodo killings. They were not actually a law and order situation that we are seeing in Assam today.
And just to understand from a very layperson perspective, what kind of a grimness, or what extent of grimness of a situation requires this kind of army deployment?
Well, when an army is deployed for law and order situation, then it means that the situation is really grim. So what does the army really do? The army carries out flag marches in disturbed areas, and by flag marches I mean, you know, you will have army convoy which is moving in a particular area with the red flag to show that the army is there. The army is called in only and only when the civil administration fails to quell a particular situation. So you had the Assam police, you had additional central armed police forces that were that were brought in into Assam, additional members were brought into Assam. They couldn't quell the situation, and the finally the army has been called in. So army gets called in only when the civil administration fails to get a grasp of a particular situation.
So essentially when a situation is a certain level of seriousness, which clearly means that Assam is at this point, as you mentioned, in an extremely grim situation.
Absolutely.
Noinima, moving on. Now, this has many connotations as far as the international community is concerned. One, the immediate neighborhood, because it talks about giving citizenship to persecuted communities in Pakistan, Bangladesh and Afghanistan, which of course does not include the Muslims. But it also has connotations as far as the rest of the international community is concerned, given how controversial this proposed legislation, it's still proposed because we yet to get the president's nod, is. So let's first begin by talking about the reactions we have seen from countries like Bangladesh and Pakistan.
So, Ruhi, the issue is when you talk about persecution of Hindus in these, countries like Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Afghanistan, this also has a direct impact on the Hindu minorities staying in these countries for several decades now. Now, the question of persecution that continues or it doesn't at this point of time is always debatable. We know what has happened in the past, and we also know what has been going on, in especially in countries like Pakistan. Sure. But when you talk about a country like Bangladesh, then the situation is slightly different, because we've seen how under the Modi regime, the Modi government, with Bangladesh, India has been able to solve the border dispute in 2015. And at that point of time, there were several exchange of enclaves. Okay. Now, some of those enclaves were also, there were people of, Hindu religion, Muslims, and everybody staying on those enclaves. So when the exchange happened, and I'm talking about a number of about, let's say, more than a million. Mm. So about, a fraction of them wanted to come to India and get citizenship here. However, a number of them stayed back.
Right.
And that is also there in public government records.
Right.
Now, why they wanted to stay back is also a reflection of how they're still confident in staying in Bangladesh as a, Hindu minority. So now it puts a question mark on what happens to them, because you are there. Potentially telling through the bill that they are now Indian citizens and they can come and get
citizenship. And that you're persecuted in your country.
And you're persecuted in your country. So, even there within the society that they live in Bangladesh, they will be now, looked down upon and, will be subjected to harassment at a very grassroots level. I'm not saying that the government will be doing that, but then this is what, is going to be the repercussion.
But how have Pakistan and Bangladesh reacted? What have leaders from the country said or representatives from the country said?
Obviously, both these countries have denied of any kind of persecution as such, for which this kind of a large-scale measure that was required from the Indian government side. But they've been also stating, and this is also coming from Pakistan as well, that this really puts a question mark on India's historical, the image of being a secular country. So what is it that you're actually stating? And we've seen voices coming out from Pakistan that how are you then different from what you have been accusing us of. And we've heard yesterday Bangladesh Foreign Minister Mr. Momin talking about the fact, and he has completely denied that there has been any persecution or they are in, the Hindu minority is any kind of potential threat.
Right. So Noinima, with Bangladesh, it's a twofold problem. One, of course, is the Citizenship Amendment Bill, where we are insinuating that Hindus are persecuted in Bangladesh. And two is the entire NRC issue. NRC, of course, has been carried out in Assam, and it essentially was carried out to identify illegal immigrants from Bangladesh. Now, Amit Shah, who's the Home Minister, has been talking about a pan-India NRC, which again indicates that, there will be a section of non-Hindu, non-Sikh, non-Christian, whatever the religions that are exempted under the Act, refugees who would be identified as illegal immigrants. And then what happens to them? Are they sent back to Bangladesh? Because that's not quite possible. So even that dynamic, is that creating a tension between the two countries?
Yes, so we have seen during the NRC issue when it was, at its peak and going on, at that time Bangladesh very openly had taken it up with the Indian government. In fact, this was an issue that the Bangladeshi Prime Minister had taken up with Prime Minister Modi. But then at that time, and even now, the Ministry of External Affairs had constantly said that Bangladesh need not worry. But we've seen, and there have been reports coming out how some, illegal immigrants from Bangladesh were recently caught and they were sent back to Kolkata, and how they are planning to now cross over. So that threat is there, and Bangladesh has been constantly flagging it out with India.
Right. Now, Snehesh, I have another very layperson question. We've seen the army deployed in Jammu and Kashmir since August 5th, increase in deployment, and I'm not talking about the border, I'm talking about the rest of the state. Now in Assam, the deployment had to be stepped up because of this. Is army only handling law and order situations now? I mean, is this in the country, isn't it becoming a little too much? There are so many law and order situations for which the army is being brought in.
So the law and order issues are taken care of by the CAPF and the Jammu and Kashmir police. But yes, increasingly, the army is called upon whenever there's a law and order situation in the rest of the country, or for that matter, for humanitarian aid.
Right.
And there are times also when, there are a number of cases in North India where, a child falls into a borewell, and the army is called in for that. No, it actually shows that somehow, somewhere, the civil administration has not been able to do its work. So, somebody who covers defense, somebody who covers security issues, I think, there are law and order issues should be completely dealt by the local authorities, that is, by the police network itself.
Right. Now, Noinima, talking about Kashmir, there was a backlash from the international community as far as the handling of the Kashmir situation is concerned. Now, I know we got the support of many countries as far as the decision to abrogate Article 370 was concerned, but just the lockdown, the kind of clampdown, the extended clampdown, many countries who even supported the decision have frowned upon it. The government was somehow managing to keep that, tied at bay, and somehow that had been receding a little bit. And now this controversial legislation has come in. What kind of potential does it have to invite international criticism?
So, Ruhi, the first fallout of this, you can see what is happening with the India-Japan summit that is scheduled to start from the 15th of this month.
The 2+2.
The 2+2 just got concluded. This is the India-Japan summit for which the Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe is expected. Now, the thing is, now probably it will be shifted out the venue and it will happen in capital. So, the Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe is expected, but right now it seems that the Ministry of External Affairs, is having an internal dialogue how to settle the situation there, because we've seen how the private airlines have also stopped carrying passengers there and cancelled all their flights. So yes, that will be the first fallout.
So is that meeting definitely being shifted out of Guwahati as was
As of
intended?
Now, there's been no official announcement, but in all probability, it will be, considering what is going on in Guwahati.
It's curfew in Guwahati.
Right. Yes, that's right. And there's internet ban. So, and this is a summit that will require everything up and running in the best possible way. So that's like the first sort of fallout, you can say. And this is internationally already people are talking about it, commentators and others. And of course, I mean, people are now, the international community per se is closely watching it and monitoring how this is going to pan out, what are the outcomes going to be. As of now, they're still dealing with it largely as an internal issue. But, this is definitely, when you talk about neighborhood first, right, this is going to be, a sort of a disaster as far as your close relationship with your neighborhood first and all that is concerned. Because we've seen so far Afghanistan is little silent, but they're also going to talk out soon. And the fact that how do you handle everything? And as you rightly said, that you were just doing a lot of firefighting with right. Kashmir, especially when it comes to the U.S. They're all closely watching it. And it depends, they will see how the Modi government deals with such a big issue.
Right. Now, very quickly, before we close, quick comments from both of you. Noinima, you on how you see it playing out as far as India's answer to the world is concerned. If there are questions raised, will they just say it's an internal matter, or will they have other justifications besides the whole persecuted minorities argument? Snehesh, you on how do you think law and order will now play out in Assam? Noinima, beginning with you.
So I would not really like to predict what the government will come out with, but I'm sure with, good orators like the External Affairs Minister, Dr. Jaishankar, the way he has been firefighting, especially, we saw what he did in Washington, D.C., going to every nook and corner and right. addressing every think tank on whatever questions they had. So I would not know if that kind of a thing
will come up.
But yes, the diplomatic channels through the back channel, a lot of talks are going on, pacifying nerves. And we also, the new European ambassador to India had recently also spoken out on the CAB stating that Europe is expecting that India will be settling this matter as per Indian constitutional standards,
right.
which is a big thing to say, although it was just a one-liner.
But which essentially means don't discriminate on the basis of
yes,
religion.
Yes, exactly. And that is what even we've heard some of the U.S. federal bodies talking about, not really the Trump administration per se, but the voices are coming out. We just saw one of the federal bodies talking about imposing sanctions on Home Minister Amit Shah. So, already things are not really looking good, but yes, again, India will have to gear up
and address
yes, right. That's right.
I will not like to speculate on how the situation will pan out from law and order wise, but I hope the situation really normalizes soon. You are from Assam, you're an expert on issues of Assam, so you would know more about how this is going to pan out in Assam itself. But as far as deployments are concerned, yes, there are additional about 20 companies from Jammu and Kashmir, right. That is the CAPF, who have moved to Assam. And as I said, the army already has heavy deployment. So the Eastern Command looks after the Northeast. So you have three divisions, and each division has about 15,000 personnel. So you have about 40,000 to 45,000 army personnel already deployed in Assam for counterinsurgency and counterterrorism operations.
Right. Well, all I can say is that the Citizenship Amendment Bill, along with the NRC that was recently conducted in Assam, they both have very deep-rooted ethnic and social connotations, and they open a lot of fault lines in Assam as far as ethnic and social issues are concerned. But now what is also happening is we are seeing a grave law and order situation. As Nahesh pointed out and as Noinama pointed out, reactions from the international community is going to be something that the Indian government will have to watch out for. Thank you so much for watching Government Matters. We'll be back with more tomorrow.